3,800 meters. It is a depth that the human mind struggles to comprehend intuitively. It is a free fall into eternity. Down here, nearly 4 kilometers of freezing water pressed down with a force of 400 atmospheres. That is the equivalent of balancing 50 heavy commercial airliners on every single square meter of your body. It is enough pressure to compress a human lung to the size of a fist and crumple steel as if it were cheap foil. There is no light here, not a single photon. It is an eternal, frozen, absolute midnight. The water temperature hovers just around freezing. It is an alien planet, more hostile to human life than the surface of Mars. And here, in this ruthless universe, it lies, the Titanic. The ship of dreams, the unsinkable, a symbol of human hubris that became a symbol of ultimate tragedy. For more than 100 years, it has rested in the dark. A ghost, a legend, a graveyard for 1,500 souls. We thought we knew everything about it. We read the books, watched the movies, memorized the survivor stories. We studied the grainy, ghostly footage from the first expeditions that captured only slivers of its rusting silhouette in the beam of a spotlight. We believed the mystery was solved. An iceberg, a gash, negligence, a lack of lifeboats. It was a tragedy, but a verified one. But we were wrong. We were only seeing a shadow. Technology has changed. It has allowed us to do what was unthinkable just a decade ago. Not just to visit, not just to look, but to penetrate its dead heart and digitize it. And what robotic drones, unmanned messengers from our world, discovered in those dead, flooded halls has shocked the scientific community. It wasn't just one discovery. It was a series of findings that are forcing us to rewrite the history of how the ship died. And the biggest discovery of all, it is not alone down there. In this icy darkness, the Titanic has company, and that company is eating it alive. Before we penetrate the hull, we must understand what we are looking for. For decades, the Titanic wasn't just a wreck, it was a phantom. Searchers hunted for it for 73 years. Dozens of expeditions, millions of dollars, all in vain. The ocean was too big, the technology too primitive. Then, in 1985, it happened. Robert Ballard's expedition found it. But few people know that this historic discovery was actually a cover story. Ballard was a naval intelligence officer. His true classified mission, funded by the U.S. Navy, was to locate 2 sunken nuclear attack submarines, the USS Thresher and the USS Scorpion. The deal with the military was simple. Find our subs, map their nuclear reactors, and if you have any time left, you can look for your Titanic. He had only 12 days left. Ballard used a new tactic. He didn't look for the ship itself. Sonars kept missing it. He looked for the debris. He knew that as the massive liner broke apart and fell, it would have left a long trail of breadcrumbs, lighter objects drifting in the current. In the final days of the expedition, the camera picked up a boiler, one of the Titanic's massive boilers. They followed the trail of coal, plates, and twisted metal, and suddenly a wall rose out of the darkness, a wall of steel, torn, black, and gigantic. It was the ship. But that was the first shock. The Titanic was not sitting on the bottom proudly and intact as artists had painted it for decades. It was broken, split in two. The bow, surprisingly intact, had plowed into the mud like a spear. The stern lay 600 meters away. And it wasn't just a stern. It was a crime scene. A mangled, exploded, unrecognizable heap of metal. The myth that the ship sank in one piece was destroyed in a single second. The tragedy was far more violent than anyone had imagined. Ballard's discovery opened the floodgates, but he only looked from the outside. Another man wanted to go in. James Cameron is not just a director, he is an obsessed explorer. For his movie, he needed more than shots of the hull. He needed to be inside. He performed dozens of dives in the Russian Mir submersibles, but that wasn't enough. he built custom bots, small, agile robotic scouts named Jake and Elwood. These were his eyes. He sent them where no human could go. Elwood slipped into the gaping black hole where the grand staircase once stood. We saw chandeliers, crusted in rust but still hanging from the ceilings. We saw the remains of staterooms, porcelain bathtubs, brass bed frames. And then he found the impossible, paper. Fragments of paper miraculously preserved in the anoxic environment. The silt, the low oxygen, and the tannins from the dissolving wood had created a perfect preservation chamber. Cameron showed us the Titanic as a haunted house. It was breathtaking, but it was still like looking through a keyhole. We saw fragments, not the whole picture. The true revolution happened recently. An expedition by Magellan Lad went to the Titanic not with cameras, with scanners.
This time, there were no manned submersibles. They deployed autonomous underwater drones named Romeo and Juliet. High-tech torpedoes packed with sensors. They needed no pilots, no tether cables. They were guided by artificial intelligence. Their mission, to map everything. Like robotic lawnmowers, they methodically combed every centimeter of the debris field. They used side-scan sonar, lasers, and 3D photogrammetry. They took 715,000 high-resolution images and collected 16 terabytes of data. On the surface, supercomputers spent weeks stitching this data together to create a digital twin of the wreck. For the first time in history, we saw the Titanic completely, without water, without darkness. It was as if someone had pulled the plug on the Atlantic and drained the ocean dry. And this model delivered the first real shock. It was terrifyingly detailed. It revealed the serial number on a propeller blade that no one had seen in 100 years. It showed rows of unopened champagne bottles resting in the sand. But most importantly, it showed that the ship is vanishing. Comparing the digital twin with photos from the 80s and 90s, scientists turned pale. The ship isn't just rusting, it is collapsing at an exponential rate. What we thought was an eternal monument turned out to be a sandcastle at high tide. The roof over the famous grand staircase has caved in. The gymnasium has collapsed. The captain's bathtub, made iconic by Cameron's film, is now visible from the outside because the wall of Captain Smith's cabin has simply fallen away. And the famous crow's nest, the post where lookout Frederick Fleet shouted the fatal words, "Iceberg right ahead," is gone. It has collapsed and dissolved. The physical point where the tragedy began has been erased from existence. The digital model allowed scientists to create a timeline of death. The verdict was harsh. We have 30 to 40 years left. After that, the Titanic will be nothing more than a shapeless orange stain on the ocean floor. But the digital twin gave us more than a forecast. It gave us the solution to the mystery of the sinking. We all know the classic story. The iceberg, like a can opener, sliced open the side of the ship, leaving a 90-meter gash. This theory was born during the initial inquiries in 1912 and seemed logical. But it is a lie. When scientists examined the 3D scans of the hull buried in the mud, they found no giant gash. There is no 300-foot hole. Instead, they saw a series of small dents, brittle fractures, and popped seams scattered across 90 meters. The iceberg didn't slice the Titanic. It hammered it. It pressed against the steel plates and popped the rivets. Thousands of rivets flew off like buttons from a tight shirt. The ship wasn't cut open, it leaked. Water rushed in not through one hole, but through thousands of narrow slits between the steel plates. It was a slow, unstoppable bleeding. But why did the pinnacle of Edorian engineering surrender so easily? The answer was found in a laboratory. Scientists analyzed fragments of steel and rivets recovered from the bottom. The culprit wasn't just the ice, it was the metal itself. The Titanic steel contained high levels of sulfur and phosphorus. By modern standards, this is unacceptable. These impurities make steel short or brittle in the cold. In warm water, the hull might have bent. In the freezing Atlantic, at -2 degrees Celsius, the steel became as brittle as glass. But that's not all. The rivets. 3 million rivets held the ship together. Analysis revealed a terrible detail. In the central part of the hull, where it was accessible, shipbuilders used strong steel rivets installed by massive hydraulic machines. But in the bow and the stern, where the hull curved sharply, the machines couldn't fit. There, workers used iron rivets, installed by hand. And this iron was not the highest best grade, but a lower best grade. It contained high levels of slag, impurities. The 3D scans proved it. All 6 compartments that flooded are located exactly where these weaker hand-installed iron rivets were used. The iceberg simply sheared their heads off. The ship was doomed back in the shipyard in Belfast. It was a giant with a glass jaw walking into a punch. But the drones found something else. Something that explains why the ship is disappearing so fast. The walls, the ceilings, the metal, everything is covered in strange orange icicles. Scientists call them rusticles, a portmanteau of rust and icicle. For a long time, we thought this was just simple oxidation, rust. But when a robotic manipulator touched one of these formations, it crumbled into dust. A sample was brought to the surface, placed under a microscope, and DNA tested. The results were horrifying. It's not chemistry, it's life. The rusticles are giant, complex cities of bacteria. And it was an entirely new species, one that exists nowhere else on Earth.
It evolved here, in the dark and the crushing pressure. It was named Halomonas titanicae. This microbe is a monster. It is an extremophile that loves the cold, the salt, and the darkness. And its only food source is iron. These bacteria are literally eating the Titanic alive. They burrow into the steel, digest it, and leave behind only brittle orange dust. Scientists have calculated the rate of consumption. These bacteria eat about 180 kilograms, 400 pounds, of iron every single day. The Titanic is not a monument, it is a reef. It is an all-you-can-eat buffet for a species that the ship itself created. These bacteria will be the ones to finally destroy the vessel. That was the second shock. But the third shock was personal. The drone didn't just scan the hull. It scanned the debris field. Thousands of hectares of seabed littered with possessions. Suitcases, hats, cooking pots. The most haunting discovery is the shoes. Pairs of shoes lying side by side, perfectly arranged, as if a person had just stepped out of them. The bodies dissolved decades ago. The bones have turned to dust. But the leather, treated with tannins, resists the bacteria. Every pair of shoes is a tombstone, a marker where a person came to rest. And there, amidst this field of sorrow, the drone scanner caught a glint. Something sparkled. It wasn't iron, and it wasn't porcelain. It was gold. The drone moved closer, cameras focusing. It was a necklace, a gold chain. But the pendant, it wasn't a diamond. It wasn't a sapphire. It was a tooth, a megalodon tooth, the fossil of a prehistoric shark that went extinct millions of years ago, set in gold. The team on the surface gasped. What was a prehistoric artifact doing on board a luxury liner in 1912? Whose was it? Was it a gambler's lucky charm? A gift for a lover? A scientist's prize? Artificial intelligence is now combing through passenger lists, analyzing clothing and old photographs, trying to link the artifact to a specific passenger. But so far, the owner remains a mystery. It is the perfect enigma, an impossible object linking three eras, the prehistoric ocean, the Edwardian luxury, and our modern technology. The drone also found hundreds of champagne bottles. Many are intact, corks still in place. They didn't implode because the pressure inside the bottle is almost equal to the pressure at the bottom of the ocean, a perfect accidental balance. It found sheet music for the song "Put Your Arms Around Me, Honey," waiting for a musician who never came back. It found the porcelain head of a doll with empty eye sockets. The drone penetrated the Titanic, and it didn't find treasure. It found the truth. Shock one, the Titanic wasn't killed by a gash, but by brittle steel and cheap iron rivets. Shock two, the ship isn't just rusting. It is being devoured by a unique mutant bacteria, Halomonas titanicae. Shock 3. Amidst this industrial tragedy lie personal secrets, like that tooth of an ancient monster, that we may never solve. Every new dive is a goodbye. We are the last generation to see the Titanic as a ship. Our children will see only a rust stain on the ocean floor. The question is no longer what happened in the past. The question is what we can save. Not the artifacts, but the memory and the data before nature finally takes back what belongs to it.